Yes, we'll be talking about a lot of new muscles today. The reason why you may not have seen these muscles is because they're actually very deep to the glutes, but they're very important muscles and very annoying muscles, actually, especially the piriformis. You're going to find out that the piriformis is one of my arch nemesises or nemesis. The piriformis just causes so many problems, but it's also a good muscle to kind of figure out so you know how to treat it. And good morning to Mia and Mujahid. Thanks so much for joining in. All right, so I think we'll get started right now, and then whoever comes in, I'll just kind of click the join button. So we're at the lateral rotator portion of the lecture. And to give you an idea of what lateral rotation does, I'll just click here. So what I have is a diagram of a mid-aged male, I guess. And if you look at his left leg, what we're trying to show or elucidate is what lateral rotation looks like at the hip, as well as medial rotation. So lateral and external rotation are synonymous, and then medial and internal rotation are also synonymous to each other. Okay, so lateral rotation while standing is the outward rotation of your hip. And you'll see that with the foot if your knee is straight, right? So your foot's gonna rotate outwardly. Internal rotation is rotating back towards midline. So your foot comes back and faces towards midline. So that's what medial and lateral rotation look like, to give you an idea. If you're sitting, it kind of looks a little different as well, but that's kind of an idea of what it looks like. Hope everyone saw that. Okay, so lateral rotators, the deeper muscles of the glutes. So in this diagram, what we've done is we've actually removed gluteus maximus, so we've retracted that out of the way. So you see in the left diagram, we've cut the big gluteus maximus, and we've also removed gluteus medius, okay? And so what we have are these deep muscles that arise from the ilium all the way down to the pubis. So they have origins from pretty much the whole entire pelvis, posteriorly at least. And then they all kind of move laterally to grab onto the femur posteriorly at the greater trochanter, as well as a bit anteriorly at the intertrochanteric line. So if you guys remember those landmarks from the previous lecture, or actually it's this lecture. Oh, wrong way. So if we go to the landmarks, the bony landmarks again, the greater trochanter again is that lateral most aspect of the femur near the hip. And then that intertrochanteric line is right over here. So those are the attachment points for these small lateral rotator muscles. Okay, so starting at the top, actually, is there anything else I want to say about these? Yeah, so when they contract, they cause that lateral rotation. And they're also kind of involved in abduction, hip abduction to some extent. So I don't have a diagram for abduction, but it's if you're standing, and you take your leg out to the side to do like a side kick. That would be hip abduction. But they're very minor abductors of the hip, but they still are kind of involved with it. Okay, so starting from the top, we got this red muscle over here. It's called the piriformis. It kind of has a pear shape to it because it's a little bit thicker in its proximal portion and thinner at its distal portion. And it makes its way from the, if you guys remember, the greater sciatic foramina from the pelvis from the previous lecture. I'll show you in the next slide as well what that looks like. And it has its attachment to the femur. Okay, that's pretty much one of the stronger lateral rotators we have in the body of the hip. And then going down, I'm just going to list them all because they kind of do the same thing. So starting from below the piriformis, we have the superior gemellus. And oddly enough, gemellus in Latin translates into twins. So that means if there's a superior portion, we have an inferior portion as well, which is the inferior gemellus. Now, in between the two gemelli, we got the obturator internus, and that's that muscle over here. And then if you look over here, we also have an obturator externus. And if you look at this view, we can only see the tendon of it because the quadratus femoris kind of gets in the way. So quadratus femoris is the most distal external rotator or lateral rotator of the hip. It gets its name because quadratus is kind of shaped like a square with four sides, hence quadratus, and femoris because it attaches to the femur. Okay, so again, they all do their same things. There's that greater sciatic notch over here. That's where that piriformis is originating from in this diagram. Okay, and then last but not least, we have this big sciatic nerve that emerges underneath the piriformis. And we'll talk about why that could be a problem for us in terms of things like sciatica. And I think I forgot to turn off my chat. So let me just stop the share for a quick second. I'm just going to turn off my WhatsApp. There we go. All right, back in action. Cool. So we got the sciatic nerve over here. Again, it emerges underneath the piriformis. Just keep that in mind. All right, so now we're gonna look at the hip rotators when we've moved all the muscles out of the way. We're gonna look at three of them specifically. So the piriformis over here, we can see how it kind of originates from the sacrum to some extent, although it has attachment points along the ischium as well. And that greater sciatic notch is over here. And we talk about those notches being important functionally. They allow certain things to move through it. In this case, the greater sciatic notch allows the piriformis to move through and attach to the femur. And then if you look more distally, we got the obturator internus and obturator externus. Okay, so if you look at the obturator internus and externus, they get their name because they originate from that obturator foramen of the pelvis, that small little hole over here, right? Now, just to kind of see if everyone remembers from last lecture, what other very important structure moves through that obturator foramen over here, that hole? And we were talking about how it had a role in innervating the hip adductor muscles. So let's see what kind of answers we'll get for that one. Arteries. Yeah, I think there might be some arteries there. Okay, we got a couple more answers. Let's see if we can get some more. Okay, so I've got a couple answers. I know there's a little bit of a lag sometimes with how I get the answers, but that's fine. Okay, so the answer, and Melanie, you're absolutely right. It's the obturator nerve. There's also the obturator artery and vein that pass through there as well. But we have that obturator nerve that comes out and emerges out of that obturator foramen, and it connects to those hip adductor muscles that we were talking about before. So, good job. All right. So, obturator internus, it emerges internally from the obturator foramen, and if you look, it comes up and has to deflect almost 90 degrees to kind of attach to the femur. Okay, whereas obturator externus originates from the external part of that obturator foramen, and has an easier path towards that femur. Okay, let's look at the nerves and the vessels now. So we talked about it in the last lecture, how the superior gluteal nerve supplies the gluteus medius as well as the maximus. I'm sorry, gluteus medius as well as the minimus. And that's because of their position, right? you would automatically assume that the superior gluteal nerve might get the gluteus maximus because of their name, superior and maximus kind of like go hand in hand, but it's more so positionally, right? So the gluteus minimus and medius are actually higher up, more superior to the gluteus maximus in terms of position of the body, which is why the nerve was named superior and it innervates the medius and the minimus, okay? Conversely, the inferior gluteal nerve supplies the gluteus maximus, okay? And then we have that big sciatic nerve. And I was talking about how it emerges underneath this red little thing over here, the piriformis. It also sometimes emerges through the muscle as well as superior to the piriformis. So more commonly, the sciatic nerve emerges underneath the piriformis, but you will have those times where either through or above the muscle as well. Now, the issue that it imposes on the sciatic nerve is that if you have piriformis syndrome, which is like the pathological tightening of the piriformis, this can cause impingement on the sciatic nerve and lead to sciatica-type symptoms. And it's just because of the sheer proximity to each other, right? So we often see that a lot in anatomy where if you have a dysfunction in a certain muscle, tendon, joint, nerve, the neighbors to that muscle, tendon, joint, or nerve are usually affected as well by its sheer proximity and association to the neighboring muscle. Okay, so that's kind of one concept I want you guys to think about. And then another cool thing about the sciatic nerve is that it's actually two nerves covered by a sheath called an epineurium. But they're grouped together at the level of the hip. But when we look at the calf, you'll see that they'll branch off into two separate nerves. We'll talk about those later. All right, let's get into the posterior thigh. And anytime you think about the posterior thigh, we think of the hamstrings. Now, people often think the hamstrings is just one muscle, but it's actually a group of 4 to 5 muscles depending on how you kind of label them. These muscles are directly below the ischial tuberosity, and most of them actually originate from the ischial tuberosity as well. So the ischial tuberosity is that distalmost portion of the pelvis at the ischium, and it's that same sitting bone we talked about earlier. All the hamstring muscles kind of originate from there. Now, the hamstrings are muscles that are often cramped and injured in runners or people that throw a lot of kicks. Those are two activities that put a lot of explosive eccentric force on the muscles. So the hamstrings have to work extra hard in people like the runners and the kickers. So we see a lot of injuries from that. These muscles also are heavily vascular, meaning they have a lot of blood supply, a lot of arteries around them. So anytime you've seen someone tear their hamstring, you'll often see a lot of bruising as well. And that's because there's a lot of blood flow that goes around in the hamstrings and in the posterior thigh region specifically. And the body kind of does that on purpose. Everything's kind of directed in front of us functionally as human beings. And so the front of our body is often more protected than the back of our body, right? So you'll find that more of these arteries are exposed in the back of the leg versus the front of the leg where we have more muscle in the way. But I thought that was kind of something interesting to note about that. They're also all innervated by one common nerve, which is the sciatic nerve. So all these hamstring muscles are innervated by a sciatic nerve, which have innervations from your L5 nerve roots as well as your S1 and S2 nerve roots. Okay. So starting from the medial most muscle, so let me guys ask you a question then. If the gracilis is the medial most muscle, and if we know that we're looking at the posterior aspect of the leg, which leg are we looking at right now? Is this the right leg or the left leg? So again, if we're looking at the posterior aspect of the leg and the gracilis is the medial most muscle in this diagram, which is this muscle over here, which leg are we looking at? Awesome. Awesome. So I love the answers. You guys are so different. I get right leg, I get right, I get R, and then I get agree by Regina. That's awesome. It's crazy how everyone has a different way to answer a one-worded answer. That's jokes. Okay, cool. That you guys are absolutely all right. So it is the right leg. So I always like to ask questions about orientation because it's important. And if you guys ever want to get more deep into anatomy and even start, you know, getting to courses where you'll have the opportunity to come to cadavers, orientation is so important, right? It's a lot easier to orient yourselves when you're looking at a diagram on a computer screen. But if you're looking at, let's say, a cadaver where everything is like the same color and you don't have these like, you know, bright little diagrams, it becomes harder. And so that's where orientation becomes your best friend as someone who cuts into cadavers, which I've had the experience of doing so. And I think it's awesome. And if you guys are ever interested, I highly, highly recommend it. It's truly, it's a humbling experience to be able to cut through a cadaver, although it might be weird to some. Just a quick story. I did that in my first and second year of physio school, cutting through the cadavers. And I think about one third of my class was very queasy about it, right? So what the process is like is that we start the very first class where all the students are all together and the professor is at the very front of the class. And we do, you know, she did a little bit of a speech where she described where these cadavers came from. And we had a moment of silence to kind of thank them for contributing their bodies to science. But yeah, one third of the class was queasy to start. They didn't even want to look at these cadavers. But towards the end of the class, everyone just got so into it. Everyone was excited to come to lab. It became second nature. So it's kind of really cool how much you can learn just from cutting through the human body and how much we have learned as a society. Sorry, a little story time. I haven't done that before, so hopefully that wasn't too boring. Okay, so gracilis, we have that medialmost muscle. It's part of the adductor group, right? So this has nothing to do with hip extension or knee extension. It's more of a hip adductor. But apart from that, all the rest of these muscles, so semimembranosus, semitendinosus, and bicep femoris, all these other muscles contribute and become the hamstrings, and they cause two major movements, right? So you'll see in the diagram over here, sorry, very poor diagrams. I added them last second. But if you look at the left one over here, the hamstring muscles cause knee flexion, which is the bending of the knee. So bringing that leg muscle backwards or bringing that shin backwards, right? But because the hamstrings also cross the hip because they originate from the ischial tuberosity, they cause hip extension. And this diagram is actually pretty cool because you have this person moving their leg backwards and you could actually see the muscles that have to activate to cause that movement. So you see the glute muscle over here, which is a huge leg extender or a hip extender, but you also see the hamstrings over here color coded causing hip extension as well. So those are the two major motions that the hamstrings cause for the leg or for the thigh, that is. Okay. So we start with the gracilis. Now, if we go a little more lateral, we get the medial most hamstring muscle, which is the semimembranosus. Now, it gets its name because it has more of a membrane-like appearance to it. It's a very flat but wide muscle. And then if you go a little bit more lateral to the semimembranosus, you get the semitendinosus. And semitendinosus gets its name because it has a very long tendon. If you look at the diagram over here, its tendon is actually longer than the membranosus tendon, but it's not as wide, okay? And this is what we call the medial hamstring. So the semimembranosus and the semitendinosus make up the medial hamstrings of our leg, okay? And now if we go to the lateral aspect of our posterior thigh, we get into the lateral hamstrings. And combined, we call them the biceps femoris. Now, I asked a question in semester one about, you know, which muscle does both elbow flexion and supination, and I got some answers as biceps, and I had to actually correct that, because if you say biceps, It could refer to either the biceps brachii, which is in your arm, or the biceps femoris, which is in your hamstring, right? So that's why I kind of made a point to say that you can't just say biceps. You have to also say the second name, because biceps can mean a few things. Whereas if you say biceps femoris, we know we're talking about the lateral hamstrings right now. Okay. So the biceps femoris gets its name because it actually has two heads. It has a long head and a short head, kind of like how the biceps brachii had, right? And then we'll talk about these muscles in more detail in the next few slides. If you go a little bit more distally, we get what is known as a popliteal fossa. So this is the popliteal region. The back of the knee is what we call the popliteal region. The fossa is the hole that's created by a few borders of the posterior leg. Okay, so on the medial border, the medial proximal border, we got the semitendinosus muscle. Okay, on the medial, on the lateral proximal border, we got the biceps femoris muscle. And on the distal, medial, and lateral borders, we got the gastrocs, which we're going to talk about in the next lecture. So that's just the calf muscle over there. And inside of here, we have a lot of important structures that we're going to talk about in lecture 4 as well, which is right after this one. Cool. All right, hamstrings. So we're going to look at the medial hamstrings, the semis, as I called them. We got the semitendinosus again, which you can now see that we've moved the glute muscles out of the way where it attaches to the ischial tuberosity of the pelvis. And as a long course and attaches to the pes anserina. So do you guys remember that pes anserina is that goose foot that attaches three other structures? So the pes anserinus attaches to that medial aspect of your tibia. And the two other structures there include the gracilis and the sartorius. Okay, so that's that third muscle that we haven't had a chance to talk about, the semitendinosus. And then we have the semimembranosus, which attaches a little bit more lateral to the ischial tuberosity. And its attachment is a little bit more posterior to the tibia over here, as opposed to medial for the semitendinosus. And because they cross both the hip and the knee, they cause both hip extension and knee flexion. Okay, let's get into the biceps portion of the hamstrings. So we call these the lateral hamstrings, but they still have that same origin point from the ischial tuberosity of your ischium of the pelvis. And we talked about how they both have a short and a long head. So interestingly enough, it's only the long head that actually attaches to the ischial tuberosity. The short head actually originates from the middle and distal regions of the femur, the femoral shaft. So if you see that in red, which is right underneath that long head. So a good exam question might be, are all of the hamstring muscles two joint muscles? And based on what I just said, the answer would be no, because the short head of the biceps femoris is actually a one joint muscle because it only crosses the knee. Now the action is, again, knee flexion because they both cross the knee, and hip extension because the long head crosses the hip. Interestingly enough, though, the two separate heads of the biceps femoris are innervated by two different parts of the sciatic nerve. So two previous slides before this, we talked about how the sciatic nerve actually branches off to two different portions. Well, the two different portions are called the tibial nerve portion, and then we got the common peroneal nerve portion of the sciatic nerve. So the long head is actually innervated by that tibial nerve portion of the sciatic nerve, whereas the short head is innervated by that common peroneal portion. Okay. So let's just do a quick review of the posterior thigh. And man, this is such a busy slide. How did this, the formatting got cut up over here. So you know what? Forget about this slide. This slide just got deformatted like crazy. Just use this for your own reference, because I do want to get into the knee lecture and make sure that we finish that on time today. And this is just another summary slide. So this is a thigh cross section. I actually do want to get into this one. So what we've done is we've taken a transverse section of our thigh. And if you look at where the femur is situated right here, right? So if we were to orient ourselves, we know that the top of the diagram is the anterior portion because we're looking at the rectus femoris over here, RF. We got the posterior aspect on the bottom over here. Okay. Now, we got the medial aspect over here because we know we're looking at gracilis, adductor magnus, adductor brevis, and adductor longus. And then we have the lateral aspect of the thigh over here with vastus lateralis. And you can see the kind of the different layers as well. So we talked about how gracilis is the medial most hip adductor muscle, and we can see it in the cross section here. Whereas vastus lateralis, the name kind of suggests it's the most lateral, most muscle. We have the sciatic nerve over here, which with its close association to the hamstring muscles. So we got the biceps femoris, we got the semitendinosus and semimembranosus. So this is kind of a trick question, but can you tell if you're looking at the left or the right leg just by looking at this diagram? And I'll see if I can get some answers. So once again, the question is, looking at this transverse section of the thigh, can you tell if you're looking at the left or the right leg? Okay, so we're getting a lot of answers, and I think it's based on how we're looking at it. So everyone's saying left. Okay, awesome. So if you guys said left, you're absolutely right. If we're looking at the superior view, so Sarah got it best. Sarah, good job. If we're looking at the superior view of it, it is the left thigh. Right? But let's flip the switch now. Let's say we're looking at the inferior view of this. Would it still be the left or the right thigh? And I think the question kind of suggests the answer is the right thigh. So awesome, Tara, you got it. So here's the tricky thing about cross-section, guys. When you look at a cross-sectional image, it really depends on whether you're looking at the inferior or the superior view of the cross section. If it is a superior view, and a lot of us, you know, when we look at a cross section, we always assume superior because we're above it. We never think of actually looking at an image like this inferiorly. So it was a trick question because it actually depends. If we were looking at it from bottom up, so let's say we were on the floor. It's a weird way to think about it, but let's say we're on the floor and we're looking up towards the thigh. So the thigh is above us. And we're looking at that cross-sectional image. We're looking at the inferior aspect. And if it's the inferior aspect of it, we're actually looking at the right thigh. Okay, so something to think about. Alrighty. No, that is not semester 32. All right, any questions before we start lecture number 4 for the knee? Are we good so far, guys? I'll give you guys a little bit of a break. Stretch it out. So as we break, I'll kind of and we got people trying to think of a question to ask. Well, if you guys ever have questions throughout the lecture, you could always just ask me as well. You could always just stop me and ask me. Okay, perfect. So lecture number four, we're going to be talking about the knee joint, and we're going to get into details about the ligaments, the menisci, and the bursa of the knee. And this will be a kind of a nice chance to show you what bursa is now, as well as how ligaments function. Because in the knee, I feel like the knee has the two most well-known ligaments in the human body, just based on how often we injure these ligaments too. Okay. And my hope is we'll be able to finish this lecture today, but we'll see. So we do have one question before we start lecture four. So the question is, can you overwork your glutes? And what is a common symptom of that? I mean, you can overwork any muscle. It doesn't matter if it's a glutes or not. It's just with the glutes, and I'll probably give you just more of a general question. The glutes are often underworked. Other muscles tend to take over, like the hamstrings and, you know, your quads. Hamstrings tend to get tight, or they tend to get weak. Quads usually most of the time get strong and tight. Glutes tend to take a back seat because I think the biggest reason is, as a society, we just sit more. But when we often have glute pain, glute region pain, it's often due to those deeper muscles, I find, those external rotators, which have to work a little bit harder because we don't use our glutes too well. But you can definitely overwork the glutes if you do a bunch of glute bridges with proper form and you do your clamshells with proper form. Or if you do a lot of, you know, stiff leg deadlifts, for example, which will get your glutes and hamstrings. But yeah, I guess hopefully that kind of answered that question to some extent. Okay, so I guess it is possible to overwork the glutes. Alrighty. So let's get into the osteology a bit. We're going to look at the tibia and fibula today. Again, this is a very busy slide, but don't get too worked up about how many things there are in the slide. There are just some main things I want you to focus on. Of course, the biggest elephant in the room is that the tibia is a lot bigger than the fibula. The tibia has much more bony mass than the fibula. But another thing to note is that if you look at the top, the tibia is actually a lot taller than the fibula. And where the femoral condyles would sit is on top of this, what we call the tibial plateau. We call it the plateaus because it's the top and it kind of has like a little bit of a pointy edge over here. And this is where, like, if you look at the posterior view specifically, you'll see kind of how it's shaped to kind of meet up with that femoral condyle from the previous lecture that we talked about. So this is the weight-bearing structure of the knee, whereas the fibula doesn't weight-bear the knee. And you could see kind of where the fibula, the head of the fibula specifically attaches to the tibia. Now, if we move down, we have another important structure over here called the tibial tuberosity. And this is a bony prominence that attaches to your patellar ligament that extends from that patella. Now, interesting thing about the tibial tuberosity is that it's a common site of injury, especially for males around the age of 8 to 10. And that's right around when they hit puberty and they start growing, having those growth spurts. And it leads to a condition known as Osgood-Schlatter syndrome. So I don't know if you guys are aware of that, but it's really just the patellar ligament that attaches here that pulls on this tibial tuberosity, causing a lot of inflammation, a lot of outward growth of this bony structure over here. And so what ends up happening is that over time, you start getting a more prominent tibial tuberosity. And this is because the quads are actually continuous with that patellar ligament. And those quads are very big muscles. And when they're super tight and when they have to like grow, especially during puberty, they will have that kind of huge pulling effect on the tibial tuberosity. So That's something that could happen over there. You got your interosseous border. So there is a space between the fibula and the tibia along the shaft. And we call that the interosseous region. Inter meaning between, osseous meaning bone, so in between the bone. But if you look at the soft tissue portion, yes, Arjun, it's part of what people will call the growing pains. So this is the most common place to have that growing pain at the tibial tuberosity. You got it. And I'll type out the syndrome that it causes. Osgood Schwader. I think that's how you spell it. Nope. Schwader's syndrome. So if you guys want to look more into it, I kind of typed it into the chat. Okay, so in between the two bones, we will have an interosseous membrane that kind of connects them as well. What else did I want to talk about? Again, you'll have your lines over here, and this is where you'll have a bunch of muscles attaching anytime you have these lines. And that's pretty much about it. I mean, if you look distally, you'll find that now the fibula is a little bit longer than the tibia. But the tibia is still the weight-bearing surface for the ankle. So when we get into the later lectures of the semester, we'll see how the tibia attaches to the talus of the foot. And then you got the medial and the lateral malleolus. And those are those bony prominences on both edges of your ankle. It's pretty much what people consider the ankle, those bony little prominences on the sides of your feet. Everyone has them. Medial, so we know we're looking at the inside. Lateral, we're looking at the outside of your ankle. Alrighty. Okay, so we're taking a more detailed look at the knee now with this image, and you'll see a bunch of structures here. I more so posted this image to show you how the femur, which is now in a flexed position. So this is with the knee bent. That's why you don't see any bone upwards over here. The knee's bent at 90 degrees. So you're seeing pretty much the whole entire condyle of the femur. This is the lateral condyle of the femur. This is the medial condyle of the femur. And I just want to show you how it articulates with the knee. So you'll see how it's kind of like a lock and key, how they're kind of built for each other to fit in. The condyles being the convex surface, whereas the tibial plateau being more of the concave surface. And then we'll talk about all these ligaments in a bit as well. And you'll notice that there's an extra diagram over here. So sorry about that. I added that last second because I want to explain what these positions would look like. But in any case, let's talk about some of the major knee joint ligaments, and we'll start with the most superficial. A lot of you are aware of the LCL and MCL. They get their name based on their position, of course. So the lateral collateral ligament, collateral meaning along the sides. So this is the one that's on the outside of your knee. It's a pretty small ligament, but it actually does go through a lot of stress. However, the incidence of injuries that happen over here is actually quite low compared to, let's say, the MCL, which is on the medial knee. And it's actually hard to injure this ligament in isolation. Now, it attaches from the lateral epicondyle of the femur to the head of that fibula. Okay. And what this ligament does is it prevents varus stress of the knee. So if you look at the top right diagram over here, the varus stress would be the very middle image. We also call it a bow leg posture. It says more stress on the medial compartment. So what they're saying is it puts more stress in the medial joint, but the lateral portion of your knee gets stretched out. And so you can imagine how if you were to put a varus stress on your knee, you would cause separation on the lateral aspect, which would cause this ligament to stretch. So this ligament over here prevents bow-legged from happening. It checks that, right? It gets tight to prevent too much of this from happening. Okay. Now, the medial collateral ligament, it's a much thicker, expansive ligament. It connects the medial epicondyle of the femur to the medial condyle of the tibia over here. Although there is some continuity towards the anterior portion of the tibia, it has most of its attachment to the medial condyle of the tibia over here. And by the way, we're looking at the anterior view of the knee, so that's why you can see the kneecap. So it's a thicker ligament. It also joins with the medial meniscus, actually, which we're going to talk about in a bit. MCL injuries are more common, especially in sports. This ligament is more stressed by a valgus stress. So the valgus stress would be what you see in this right image over here. We also call it a knock knee posture. And you have more stress on the lateral compartment of the knee now, so the outside of the knee joint. But the inside, the medial aspect of the knee, is getting stretched out. And that's what the medial collateral ligament is actually trying to prevent. So it gives that medial aspect of the knee some support. I hope that makes sense, guys. Let me know if you have questions about that specifically. And then we're just looking at the medial and the lateral views of the knee. So the medial view, you can see that medial collateral ligament, the MCL, and you could actually even see its attachment to the internal structures like the meniscus. If you look at this deflection of the ligaments, we got the patella over here. We got the quadriceps tendon. So if you guys remember the quadriceps tendon, that's above the patella. And then below the patella, we have the patellar ligament. So quadriceps tendon is muscle to bone. Patellar ligament is bone to bone. Now, the question I have for you about this slide is, what muscles kind of merge and continue into the quadriceps tendon? I'm looking for four of them. So this is from the previous lecture. What muscles continue into the quadriceps tendon? So I'll give you guys a few seconds to answer that one. Still no answers. So the quadriceps is more anteriorly. The hamstrings would actually be more posteriorly. No, no worries at all. Okay, so for sartorius, let's talk about sartorius a bit more. So sartorius originates from the anterior superior iliac spine, and it crosses the thigh from the lateral aspect of the hip to the medial aspect, and the sartorius actually attaches to the pes anserinus, which is that goose foot on the medial aspect of your tibia. So it wouldn't be the sartorius, but it's a good guess. And gracilis, no, gracilis would be more that medial muscle. So remember, gracilis originates from the medial aspect of the pelvis and attached to that pes anserinus, kind of like how the sartorius does. But I could use some more coffee too, actually, Tara. I'm with you on that one. So we got rectus femoris, vastus lateralis, vastus medialis, good. And vastus intermedius, awesome. Sarah definitely had her coffee today. But a lot of good answers, and you guys are absolutely right. Those are all structures around the front of the thigh or the medial thigh. So remember, when we talk about the quads or quadriceps tendon, we talk about, you know, all the quads, right? So we talked about the rectus femoris, which is the most anterior quad. We talked about the vastus intermedius, which is the most deep quad. But then we have the vastus lateralis and the vastus medialis, right? So those are all kind of continuous with that quadriceps tendon. Now, my next question is, what is the nerve that's supplying all these muscles? And for bonus points, what are the nerve roots that this nerve originates from. And I kind of gave you a funny way to remember those nerves. Okay, so we pretty much have two major options, right? The two major nerves we talked about, or actually three. We've talked about three major nerves that go down the thigh, right? So we talked about the sciatic nerve recently. We talked about the obturator nerve in the previous lecture for the adductors, and we talked about the femoral nerve, right? So the sciatic nerve is a nerve that's going to get more of the hamstrings. So we got the semitendinosus, semimembranosus, and we got the biceps femoris. We got the obturator nerve, which is going to get adductor brevis, adductor longus, and a portion of abductor magnus. And then we got the femoral nerve, which is going to get the quadriceps, right? So we're talking about all those four quadricep muscles. And L234 is what I was looking for in terms of nerve. Absolutely. And the easy way to remember that is L234 kicks the door. And we say kicks the door because all the muscles involved in kicking a door are innervated by the femoral nerve. But good job, guys. Alrighty, let's talk about some bursa. So you guys have heard of bursa before, particularly bursitis. Now, the bursa are fluid-filled sacs. They're filled with a fluid called synovial fluid, and they're lined by a synovial membrane. So they're just these sacs, right? They function to reduce the friction between the body's soft tissue and the body's tough tissue. So they're usually found between muscles or tendons or ligaments and bony prominences. And we have two major examples of bursa in the knee, but we'll talk about them in a bit. So they function to provide a frictionless surface between the bony and the soft structures in the knee, as well as other regions of the body. They're also shock absorbers, so they function to some extent, at least, to soften blows to certain parts of the body. Now, if you injure them, they tend to inflame into what we call a bursitis, right? So itis meaning inflammation, bursa, so inflammation of the bursa. And that leads to a bit of swelling. And one very common type of bursitis is a prepatellar bursitis. This is inflammation of that prepatellar bursa over here. So the prepatellar bursa is the one that sits between the apex of the patella, which is the bottom patella, and the skin that kind of covers the knee, right? So when there's a bursitis over there, it leads to inflammation and swelling that can cause a bump, if you see in the bottom right of this diagram over here. I don't know if you guys have this image. I'm pretty sure you don't, because I added this last section, so sorry about that. Now, what would cause a prepatellar bursitis in this instance? They also call it this type of bursitis, prepatellar bursitis. They also call it housemaid's bursitis, I believe, which is like an old school term for it. And the reason behind this is that anyone who's on their knee, let's say cleaning the floor, or if you're on your knee for a very long time, you're actually putting a lot of pressure on that bursa. And over time, it will lead to a swelling and inflammation. And yes, she definitely needs gardening pads. So over time, we've gotten smarter as a society, and we've invented things like gardening pads, which would definitely help with this. The prepatellar bursa is one of the major ones. Prepatellar meaning before a patella, so you can see that it's in front of the patella. We also have a suprapatellar bursa. So that's one that sits primarily above, superior to the patella, but it's in between the patella and the femur. And so what that does is it allows your patella to glide pretty frictionless along your femur. And remember how the patella sits along the front of that femur in that patellar notch that the femur has? So That would be the function of the suprapatellar bursa over here. Okay. And then we have an interesting little muscle called the articularis genu. And this is a muscle that hooks up from the vastus intermedialis superiorly and attaches to the suprapatellar bursa superiorly. And it contracts to pull on this patella, suprapatellar bursa to tighten it up a little bit. And it does it primarily when the knee is in extension. So the reason why I want to highlight this muscle in the first place is to show that sometimes muscles are not meant to move joints. You're actually meant to tighten up things. And this is one prime example of a muscle that doesn't really move a joint at all. It just helps tighten something up. Okay, and then we got the patella over here. We were kind of talking about that. We got the patellar ligament that attaches the apex of the patella to your tibial tuberosity, which we just talked about earlier. Alrighty. Let's get into the cruciate ligaments now. So the cruciate ligaments are named because cruciate actually translates into cross-shaped. So these ligaments cross each other in the knee joint. But they're also named based on their position, based on their attachment to the tibia. So we have the anterior cruciate ligament, and we have the posterior cruciate ligament. Now, I didn't write ligament, so just write ligament there in your minds. And of course, their short form is ACL and PCL, which I probably should have put on the slide as well. But that's me not drinking enough coffee. So these ligaments are avascular, meaning they don't really get any blood supply. Okay. They're actually completely bathed in synovial fluid. But this does have some implications, especially during injury. So if they get torn, they don't really grow back properly. And this is why we often see ACL reconstructions happening when we tear ACL, for example, which is the blue one in this diagram. Okay. Again, blood flow is important for recovery. So anytime a tissue could have blood flow, it has a higher propensity to heal. Okay. And if you were to look at the hierarchy of tissues and their ability to, let's say, recover from an injury, let's talk about all the tissues actually. And I want to get you guys feedback as to which one you guys think gets has the highest propensity to heal. So we have ligaments, we have muscles, we have bones, and we have tendons. So once again, ligaments, muscles, bones, and tendons. Which one of you guys, which one out of those four do you guys think have the best propensity to heal? And I guess the second part to that question is, can you guys kind of list in order from best healing to worst healing? Wow, quick answer already. Wow, everyone's on point today with their answers. I'm going to wait for a couple more answers and then we'll talk about why. But so far, we're getting some really good answers. Okay. So, okay, we are getting some different answers. All right, cool. So let's talk about what the answer is. So the highest propensity to heal out of any structure is actually your bones. The bones, because bones have bone marrow, and a lot of really strong, helpful, tissues like bone, like blood and stuff, originate from the bones, right? Like they'll develop from the bone marrow. The bone is a very dynamic tissue as well. In fact, when bone heals, it actually heals stronger than it was before. So if you were to let's say fracture your bone, sorry, I'm just looking at all the answers right now. If you were to fracture your bone and it were to heal in place, where that bone heals, it heals with a hard callus bone that is actually stronger than it was before. So you're not actually going to break in the same place twice, which is very fascinating about bone. So in terms of blood flow, at the top of the list, we actually got bone, and then we got muscle. Muscle, it has a lot of blood flow as well. It has a great propensity to heal. No, guys, don't try breaking your bones. It's not going to make you stronger, I promise. And then below that, we got tendons. And at the very end, we got ligaments. So that's the hierarchy. So bones, muscles, tendons, ligaments in terms of propensity to heal. So ligaments being at the very bottom of the list, it has the least blood flow, has the least propensity to heal. That's why we try not to tear them as much as possible, okay? But if we do tear them, they often don't heal properly. This is why we do reconstruction type surgeries on these ligaments. And I don't think, well, if you guys are willing to go a little bit later, I might be able to finish the lecture. We might have to go 5 to 10 minutes later. So if you guys are okay with that, let me know. If you guys have to leave early, let me know as well. We'll do a bit based on what everyone can do, but I'll keep teaching the lecture. And just, if anyone can't make it, just let me know. Oh, Sarah got locked out. Oh, so you know what? What I will do is I'll just finish off the next couple of slides. I think I gotta be fair with the time too. Sorry, Sarah. I just realized that you got locked out of lecture. So hopefully you didn't miss too much of it. We were just talking about the cruciate ligaments, and we're talking about how ligaments don't heal too well. We also talked about why the blood flow to the ligaments are not that great. In terms of propensity to heal, bones heal the best, muscles are second best, tendons are third best, and ligaments are the worst in terms of healing. So ligaments, when we tear them, we usually can't heal them properly. They don't heal properly, they don't grow back properly, so we usually do a reconstruction on them. So that's pretty much what you may have missed with that. And no worries at all, don't worry about that. All right. Actually, you know what? We'll end off at that because this is a pretty busy slide. So what we'll do is we'll start next lecture with the cruciate ligaments function, their functions. But yeah, you know what? Let's stop over here, and then we'll just, because there's only 3 slides anyways, and I don't want to rush through these because I do want to talk about the function of these ligaments in detail because I think it's really important. I also like talking about the superior view of the tibia because there's a lot of important structures here to talk about as well. And then we got the coronal section of the knee. Okay, so we'll start off with this slide in the next lecture. If you guys have any questions about the previous slides, just let me know. I'll be here for the next 5 to 10 minutes. If you want me to go over anything again, let me know as well. But otherwise, as always, thank you guys so much for tuning in. Lecture number 5 is going to be Tuesday, May 26th. And I think we're going to start getting into the leg portion of things. But yeah, I'm here for any questions at all. So if you have any questions, just feel free to let me know. That's interesting how someone could get hungry looking at a cadaver. Very interesting. Another weird thing about cadavers is you got to lace them with a lot of formaldehyde to prevent the stench from happening. So I don't know how your brother could have even remotely wanted to eat chicken. Well, he's always hungry, so I guess that's a good reason. But yeah, if you've ever seen a cadaver, they are laced with a lot of formaldehyde, and it's done to preserve the body, right? So the body would decay a lot faster without the formaldehyde. The problem with the formaldehyde is you don't want to touch it, so we're always wearing, you know, goggles and we're wearing our gloves and stuff because it is a very potent carcinogen. But they use that formaldehyde to preserve the bodies, but it has a terrible smell, so. Did you talk about where they would take the ligament from in order to repair them? That's a good question. What they would try to do, well, so they would try to do two things. And thanks, guys. Have a good weekend as well. But to answer your question, Sarah, it really depends on how frayed the ends are, the two ends are of the ligaments. What they would try to do is, if it's a partial tear of the ACL, they'll try to take whatever frayed out in terms of the tail and tear and reattach them using surgical, you know, staples and whatnot to reinforce it. If they cannot do that, then what they'll do is they'll do a full reconstruction. So they'll actually get rid of the ends that got torn. And they have two sources that they can replace the ligament with. And it's really 50-50 based on which one they'll use. So they'll either use your patellar ligament. So they'll take a piece of your patellar ligament and create that as your new ACL, or they'll take a piece of your hamstring tendon. And the pieces are called grafts. You could either get it from a cadaver, which is called an allograft, or you can take it from your own body, which is more commonly what happens, which is called an autograft. But in either case, they'll take it from either the patellar ligament or your hamstring tendon. Both have their consequences for the knee as well. So if you were to take it from your patellar ligament, for example, you might have some anterior knee pain just because of the surgical removal of some of that patellar ligament. Conversely, if you were to take it from your hamstring tendon, I'm pretty sure it might be the semitendinosus given how much tendon it offers. They obviously don't take all of the tendon. They'll take like a small graft of it. But if you take it from there, you might present with a little bit of hamstring tightness after surgery as well. And so the rehab after an ACL reconstruction does differ a little bit depending on where you get the graft from. Now, sometimes they'll take it from a cadaver, so that's the allograft. And you might think that they would do it more often from a cadaver, but the reason why they don't is that the autograft, which is from your own human body, A, is accepted much more in terms of your immune system, and B, is actually a lot stronger. So the cadaver grafts aren't as strong as your own grafts. So those are pretty much the sources for your ACL reconstruction. Alrighty. And don't be shy if you guys have any more questions. I'm here for another few minutes, so ask away. Interesting. A thread of their IT band. Yeah, I've never heard of them using the IT band, but sometimes they will try weird regions. I find they'll do that if someone already presents with a patellar ligament problem or a hamstring problem. So it wouldn't be wise to take from the patellar ligament if, let's say, the person presents with like tendonitis in that region already. So that might be one reason why they may have gone to the IT band. Yeah.